More than 25 years I have been working in the IT industry, 10 years in mobility, and 8 years of this I have been working in Asia. I had the luck to find the right partners and colleagues to build up a company almost 10 years ago, and we became tremendously famous for building user interfaces. User interfaces in mobility are the things you see first time when you switch on a device. And our innovation, what we become famous for, was that we could use the finger actually for device operations. When we came out with this kind of idea, people told us, is it a good idea? Your finger is dirty, your screen gets dirty as well. A few months later, Apple announced the iPhone. And Steve Jobs threw the stylus over the shoulder and said, we have the finger. And everyone understood the concept of using the finger for device operations. Company grew over the last years and was acquired a few months back from the biggest European internet company, Yandex. So, what I'd like to share is some ideas about mobility. When the TEDx organizer came to me and asked, share some ideas. The first what I replied to them was, what about mobility? Mobility is out. I said, oops, how can be mobility out? Mobility was my life, and it is, let's say, a part of all of our life. What I meant, actually, was that mobility lost the way that it's only mobility. When we speak about a mobile device, we speak about something which is widely connected. And today I'd like to share you some ideas about this, about how the connection is done, and what it means for you as a user in your selection process of a mobile device. Okay, but maybe first let's step a little bit back to the history of mobile phones. In the 60s, maybe you see all James Bond movies where they had a phone already in the car. It filled up a completely entire trunk of a car. So, and it was in 83 on a trade exhibition where I saw people carrying around a phone like a suitcase. Got a long arm, 8 kilograms. These people must be so important, I thought. So actually, I bought a device as well. Shortly after this, I built it into my car. So this was about 84. Shortly before, there was a phone which was in US, Dynatac of Motorola. It came out 83. It was the first phone which you really could hand in one hand. Well, you have to be, let's say, strong arms. It weighed 792 grams at this time. And it cost, at this time, it was about $4,000. So two calls for each half an hour, and you do not need any more exercises. Okay, and we had a change to a digital system in the beginning of 91, so everything becomes much smaller. And I think every corporation at 93, 94, it was filled up with phones. And every sales guy, everyone who was, let's say, need to be connected over the day, had a phone at this time. And in 2000, the phones become even lighter. But at this time, something else happened. Functionality from computers, from organizer, and phone become to merge. Phone became more and more intelligent. And an intelligent phone today, where computer-enabled phone, is called a smartphone. So today, we have these kind of smartphones. You see that the from long arm to strong arms to free work to this kind of work has changed a little bit of our operation. Oh, may I can ask you, who of you is having a smartphone? Please raise your hand. Okay. Double check. Raise your hand if you do not have a smartphone. Okay. This is what I expected. Especially if you ask young people, you will see like this. If you ask a young person, what do you like to have? If you have only one choice, a car or a smartphone, 46% decided to have a smartphone. I think it's a big number, and astonishingly, this number is growing. So, but the correlation was okay. Right now, we have about 470 million smartphones in the world. And you see the growth rate here. That's tremendous. 630 next year, so some of you will have another smartphone soon. But in 2015, where we have more than 1.1 billion smartphones in the world, every one of you, each individual person, will have a smartphone. Not because a smartphone is so nice. Not because now people use a smartphone and have nice toys on it and maybe you will be able to afford it. No, you will have a smartphone because things in daily life will not be any more available without having a smartphone. You want to be connected with your colleagues. You want to be connected with other people. And you need the right tool to be connected. And this will be somehow digital. It does not need to be a phone. It can be your computer. But somehow you need to be connected. The future of phone, I think this kind of discussion would take hours and hours. If we speak about technical details, these kind of phones get more and more sensors. The people who know have now, let's say, more intelligent phones, they know already they have a GPS sensor inside. A GPS tracks the information where you are. Shows you via satellite navigation almost good where, let's say, in a few hundred meters or maybe 50 meters where you are. But adding additional, let's say, satellite navigation tools like GLONASS in Russia or Galileo from Europe, you will have a much more precise information where you are on several meters exact. So the things becomes more accurate. And becomes more faster. Today we speak about, everyone is speaking here in Thailand about 3G. Just coming out here. It's well established in Europe. We are thinking about having the next generation, which is called 4G. There are tests rolling out already in South Korea and in Japan and in many, many other countries in the world, which tenfold the capacity of a 3G what we have today. But this is not all. If you look to the research people, then you know that they are, let's say, planning for 2020 a system which is called 5G, which again raises the bar extremely to a high level. That means that the connectivity will always more easy and more faster and more seamless. Why we need it? Because a mobile device will be a seamless device. It will be connected with all the other tools. You see this kind of clouds here. People speak about cloud computing. We'll have our files not anymore stored on a physical file, on a phone, on this desktop. We will put our files where we can access them everywhere. And it doesn't mean that it's only on your phone. It can be in your car, on your tablet, or on your desktop, or on your desktop in the hotel room. This happens already. It is, let's say, it's nothing where you speak about future. The future only happens if everyone is using it, and this will definitely come. We have this kind of vendor machine, which is quite nice. Vendor machines with NFC, called near field communication, they put it into phones, and will allow your wallet in your phone. That means you don't need any more money with you. You take your phone and you pay with your phone. It's quite realistic. When you're in a queue on an airport, checking in, you have seen that many boarding passes are already, let's say, digital. People take their digital boarding pass. They don't use any more paperwork. By knowing that more and more connectivity will come up, it becomes more and more important to know what kind of device is connected to what you have. When you buy a computer, and you go to a shop, you will definitely say, okay, I want to have an Apple, or I want to have a PC. which runs with Microsoft DOS somehow on the low level. These kind of operating systems exist in the mobile space as well. Ah, you can't read it here, that's okay. You see that there's a blue one, which is called Symbian. And you see that over the time, the operating system Symbian will almost disappear. For you, this kind of slides is only good to know that there's a change in operating system in the mobile space. The big winners for the future will be iPhone, and the yellow one, and the biggest winner will be Android. Predicted in 2015 is that Android will almost have 50% of the entire market. And the biggest other group will be iPhone, iOS, and Microsoft operating system. And then there will be shared some rest from others. When you are in a shop situation, you have this kind of Garden of Eden with this kind of nice, beautiful, hanging devices. And you can choose one of them. But you have to know if you choose it, you choose an ecosystem, which is in the device. And here, let's say, we have to a little bit, let's say, change a bit the idea of, let's say, using our digital world. Because each of these kind of phones is having its own comfort zone and their own ecosystem. You think it's nice to have this kind of phone, it just might be nice, but this kind of phone will definitely bring you to one search, to one marketplace, to one music store, to one, maybe, social network. And by using all of this, you say, oh, it's so nicely connected, I use this kind of tools. You will be happy. You stay in the comfort zone, you're using one of these kind of ecosystems. And in the end, all these ecosystems will be different, but everything what you do, every search of what you do, every buy, every shop, every time when you do something with your phone, you will be a part of the ecosystem and you will pay money to this ecosystem. Or someone else will pay money to this ecosystem if you don't pay yourself. These kind of systems are built with wall around it. Make it easy thing. Try to buy a music in a music store of one system and try to bring it to another phone. Have anyone try to do this? It's not supposed to do this. If you buy an iTunes, a music piece, a music, then it is supposed that this kind of music will play on all your iTunes player in your home. But bring it to another phone, another ecosystem, that is not the idea. That is not the idea of a shop, and it's not the idea of these kind of ecosystems. These ecosystems are built, these kind of walls are built to protect the business inside your phone. And the walls can be very strong and can be a little bit different. So every system has, let's say, their specific ideas behind it. I always say that if you see iPhone, then iPhone is the North Korea of the ecosystems. It has the most strongest walls, for sure. How they can make money, by the way? If you use search, if you buy, let's say, from time to time a music title, how they can really make money? I will tell you, they make a big money. Is it bad? No. They give it comfort for you. They make it easy to buy something, what you really need and desire. So this is good. If you're looking for a restaurant, and you enter, I'm looking for a Thai restaurant, and you enter it twice or three times, the system will automatically start to give you, let's say, this kind of idea, looking for a Thai restaurant. And when you're looking next time for I'm hungry, it will show you a Thai restaurant. Because they know automatically that you are interested in Thai restaurants. Is it good? For sure. It makes life more easy. But something has happened in behind. There's, let's say, the system tried to set up the most comfortable way you are using the system. The most comfortable way they think that you want to have things. And here I think, and this is the only message I have today for you, is that you have to be aware that you will get answers in a way you answered things before. If you, let's say, stay free and you want to, let's say, get discover the system and discover things in a new way, you should set up the environment for yourself. Using only one social network, for example, because you just came up with one using, is it a good idea? I would say, try others as well. Use others as well. If you have a friend which has a different phone, try the phone, try it out, use it. Don't stay with one system, don't stay with one ecosystem, don't stay with one missionary. As often you can, try to use other stuff. Try to search with different search engines. There is more than Google on the market. There's Yandex, there's in China Baidu. There are other things you can use, and you should definitely try it to broaden your, let's say, your expertise in the market. Don't let set up your, let's say, the way on your life, on your digital life, by closed ecosystems. Well, you might have seen this this week. I think we have seen this on internet over the last days. If I say, what is Protect IP Act? How does it sound? I think it sounds good. Stop Online Piracy Act. How does it sound? Does it sound good? Okay, it sounds harmless. It sounds good. Yes, we want to stop piracy, right? Do we want to stop piracy? I think everyone says, yes, sure. But the way how they do it can be done, let's say, very badly. There are two congressional bills in US which was on the table until this week. And web pages like Wikipedia and more than 6,000 other pages have been running big protest against it. And well, with effect, it looks very good that people, let's say, start to rethink. And for me, it was a good sign, a good encouragement that we can still, let's say, influence the way around us. We should keep, let's say, the systems open, and we should keep, let's say, the way how we search and how we act with our systems as open as much as we can. Thank you very much.